Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Mrinmay Pramanik. I teach Comparative Indian Language and Literature at the University of Calcutta. Today we will discuss a module from the paper Indian Aesthetics, and this module is on Bhartrihari and his Vakyavadhya and the concept of Sphota. Bhartrihari was known as a philosopher in the Indian intellectual tradition. He has established grammar as a philosophical doctrine through his text Vakyavadhya. His personal details are not found in great length. It is said that he existed around 450 to 510 AD. He was mentioned in the travelogue of the Chinese monk Yi Xing or Yi Xing. Along with Vakyavadhya, a commentary on Patanjali's Mahabhashya named as Mahabhashya Deepika or Mahavastika is also written by Bhartrihari. Bhartrihari is also known as the author of Satakatraya, but views differ about the identical authorship of these two works. It is said that Vartikavya is also authored by Bhartrihari. Vakyavadhya is divided in three khandas or chapters, such as Brahmakanda, first chapter, Vakyakanda, second chapter, and Prakirnakanda, third chapter. The whole text is composed in Anushtup meter called Karika. To explain the text, Bhartrihari himself wrote a commentary called Vritti. This commentary is available for first two chapters of Vakyavadhya. In the commentary, the author is called as Hari Vrishabha, though the genuine commentary, which is mentioned by Yi Xing, contained 7,000 slokas, is not available now. In the form of abridgment and adaptation of this commentary through the works of others is available in print form. The first two chapters of the text are commented by Vrishavadeva through his commentary called Paddhati. Here Paddhati is found along with Vritti, but the Paddhati of the Vakyakanda is not found today. This text is lost now. Vrishavadeva's time is around first half of the 8th century. On the Vakyakanda, the commentary of Purna Raja is available in print today. The form his introduction, it is understood that there was a commentary of him on the first Kanda also, but it is not available. It is inferred that his time was around 9th century, Kashmir. On the Prakirna Kanda, the commentary named Prakirna Prakasha of Hela Raja is found. His commentary on first two Kandas is named as Sabda Prabha. But this particular commentary and some portion of Prakirna Prakasha is lost today. The lost portion is written again by Phula Raja. Hela Raja's time is most probably middle of the 11th century. The text Vakyavadhya is not taught today without these commentaries traditionally. To comprehend the text, it is necessary to know these commentaries also. Now let us talk about Shabda Brahma. As it is mentioned earlier, also the first chapter of Vakyavadhya is known as Brahmakanda. Through the first four Karika, Bhartrihari establishes the concept of Shabda Brahma. In this theory, the whole world turns or vivartate or manifested into the meaning from the Brahman, who does not have any beginning or end, who is all pervaded, whose very essence is word. Brahman is principle beyond all conceptual constructions. The manifestation of Brahman appears as temporal and spiritually ordered. But the Brahman remains unaffected. So the world is created from Brahman, but he did not create it. The world is manifested. This manifestation is understood linguistically, and the Brahman is to be considered as permanent syllable. This manifestation is like a bubble. It can go back to its origin. The permanent letter is manifested through the meaning, and this meaning is the whole world. Brahman is single, but appeared as many due to its various powers. The powers and Brahman appears to be different from each other, but they appear different when they assume the form of different objects which figure in them. The six modifications, such as birth or jayate, existence or asti, transformation or viparinamate, growing or vardhate, decay or apakshate, destroy or vinashyati, are the source of the different states among life. The modification depend on time or kala shakti, which is the power of Brahman. Other powers depend on the independent power of time. These modifications have sequential occurrences. This sequence is marked with the scale of time. Through this process, the circle of existence works. The single seed of all things have three different characters. It is the experience or vaktri, experienced or bhokta, and experience as bhoga. Here the term bhoga is interpreted as the experience of happiness, sadness, etc. The one Brahman is the substratum of powers. These powers cannot be defined either identical or different from it. This can be explained as the state of dream. In the dream, one can experience different things at one time, but those experiences do not have any existence in reality other than dream. These three different things are actually manifestation of Brahman. The Bhartrihari established the theory of Sabda Brahman. After establishing the theory of Sabda Brahman, Bhartrihari proceeds to establish grammar as the subject, which not only helps to get the correct knowledge of Vedic words and as well as Laukika, language in general, as the greatest way to attain salvation or moksha. He also considers grammar as Agama Shastra or Smriti. The theory of Sphota. The term Sphota is explained as Sphutyate Arthaha Yasmat, from which meaning is blossomed. According to grammarians, words convey meaning. Now the problem is where this meaning does reside, or what the substratum of meaning is. The meaning can be resided on letters, but letters are perishable. The meaning which is eternal cannot be stayed in the perishable object. To comprehend a word, each and every letter is necessary. It is not the case that from the first letter itself the meaning is comprehended. Then other letters of the word would be redundant. If it is said that the arrangement of letter holds the meaning, then there would be question that how an arrangement of perishable object can become eternal. Because in a word, letters come one by one, and when one letter is uttered and destroyed, then only another letter could come into existence. Considering these issues, grammarians postulate a meaning bearing entity. Other than word or pada, the letter or varna, this entity is called sphota. The sphota is eternal, and according to the grammarians, this sphota is shabda. This shabda, it is its meaning and their relation is eternal or nitya. Now let us talk about Vakya Kanda. After establishing Shabda Brahman and the theory of Sphota, Bhartrihari proceeds towards sentence. According to Bhartrihari, sentence and the sentence meaning are indivisible units. Communication takes place through sentence only, not by individual words. In order to establish his view, he mentions the views on sentences from other school of philosophy. He refutes the views of others, especially of Mimamsakas. Though the name of any particular Mimamsakas is not mentioned, at the beginning of the second chapter, he has also mentioned the 8 ways to define sentence according to the view of logicians. The view of Mimamsakas is presented in 5 different ways. According to them, that the sentence is a collection or sanghata of words. A word is outside of a sentence has certain meaning. When it enters in a sentence, it conveys the same meaning, neither more nor less. The words get together and lead to a sentential meaning. This sentential meaning is a new meaning over and above the meanings of individual world. This meaning is called samsarga, that is mutual connection, like the number 10 exists in all the 10 objects which are counted taken together, not in each of them. The word meaning is universal, capable of denoting all particulars. In the presence of another words, the meaning becomes restricted to one single particular. In that state, it is called sentence meaning. From another viewpoint, sentence is not verbal because it comes in a sequence and sequence cannot come under the perception. Hearing is also one kind of perception. Sequence is a property of time and it is superimposed on the individual words. In this view, also the sentence meaning consists of connection of individual words. It emphasizes on the sequence, not the individual words which are heard. The sentence meaning does not come from individual words, but from their meanings which are incomplete and require one another or akanksha. This view is known as Avihitanvayavada. Some Mimamsakas think that the verb is the sentence. Verb denotes action. The accomplishment of the action is also comprehended from verb. Thus, the meaning is completed. So, the verb can be considered as sentence. Another view is called as Anvitavidanavada. Here, the connection with the meaning of other words is part of the meaning of a word. Word meanings are connected. This connection is experienced by the users of the sentences. The very first word conveys the meaning as connected with other words. The first word conveys only the abstracted, unconnected universal. This universal becomes connected with the other, the meaning which emerges from it is called sentence meaning. These views are refuted by Bhartrihari. The sentence is indivisible. It can be divisible when it is manifested through utterance. But therefore, manifestation, it resides in speaker's mind as indivisible, complete entity. According to him, the meaning is comprehended in flash of understanding of the meaning of the whole sentence. It is quite different than the meaning of our individual words. This flash or intuition is described as prativa. It connects together the meanings conveyed by the different words of a sentence. It relates the sentence as a whole on which it rests. Even it exists in animals also. Because of this prativa, the birds and the animals engage in their natural activities without any instruction. Pratibha includes intelligence, intuitive knowledge, and the spontaneous activities of newborn babies. Bhartrihari tells 6 causes of Pratibha, such as Swabhava, Karana, Abhyasa, Yoga, Adrishta, and Visishtopahita. The chief characteristic of sentence is the completeness. This completeness does not depend on any particular number of words in a sentence. When verb expresses an action or process with other words as accessories, a sentence is considered to be complete. Though to serve practical purposes, Bhartrihari accepts the splitting of sentence. But according to him, these parts are not real. They are all imaginable. Grammar does the analysis for understanding of ordinary mortals. This analysis can be used by others to serve their purpose. As Mimamsakas can use this analysis to interpret Vedic injunctions. The nature of sentence is whole. Though the meaning of a sentence and its form have an external aspect, but actually they are inner quality. They are derived from the Brahman. They are itself is a spark of that Sabda Brahman, which represents the total knowledge. The meaning is manifested before the meaning of sentence is fully grasped. Some other elements such as individual words and their meanings are organized. But they are not real. They are the means by which the final clear cognition takes place. Now, let us focus on Prakirna Kanda. After establishing Sabda Brahman and the sentence and sentence meaning as a part of it, Bhartrihari moves towards the discussion of grammatical analysis. Each grammatical category is divided in sub-chapters and named as Samuddesha, such as Jati Samuddesha, Dravya Samuddesha, Guna Samuddesha, Sadhana Samuddesha, Kala Samuddesha, Kriya Samuddesha, Linga Samuddesha, Vritti Samuddesha, etc. The first point among these is whether the word and its meaning is universal or jati or substance or dravya. Grammarians in general accept both. First, they have accepted universal. After that, they have accepted particular also. Here also Bhartrihari mentions several views on the topic. Vajapayana thinks that all words and the parts of the words denote the universal. On the other hand, Vyadi thinks that they denote substance. These views were placed with the explanation of rules of Panini. According to the first view, when the word gau or cow is uttered, it is understood that cowness exists in all cows, which are different in colors, etc. Because of this cowness, the cow is comprehended across the time and the place. But this universal must resides in some kind of substratum. The suffix part of the verb conveys the idea of universal. The nouns in a sentence convey the universals of the accessories in a specific way, and the universal of the action conveyed by the verb enters into a relation with them. Though the particular where they reside in the particular vyakti, there is universal and also the power of accessory. The universal is eternal, but any particular instance of it is a process and not eternal. The prefixes or upasarga of verb expresses peculiar of that very action which is universal in nature. Even proper names denote the universal and the permanent aspect of particular persons who are constantly changing from infancy to old age. The other view is that all words denote dravya or substance. The individual, the concrete, the particular, the dravya as presented by word is defined as something which is to be qualified, to be distinguished from other things and which can be referred to by a pronoun. Sometimes a distinction is made between the same color of two different things, thus as the red in rose or the red in the sky during sunset. After dravya quality, guna is discussed. The question arises here that how different grammatical categories such as suffixes, etc. bring out the special quality of word. For example, the suffix tva in the word Raja Purushatva denotes the relation of master and the servant involved in the compound Raja Purusha. Quality gives a name to a entity and distinguishes it from other things. In Bhartrihari's metaphysics, four kinds of power are discussed, such as dik or direction, sadhana means kriya action, kala time, among other concepts which are discussed here in the third chapters of Vakyapadiya, the concept of action and the concept of karaka or sadhana are important. According to Bhartrihari, the concept of action or kriya is beyond perception. It can be inferred. It is explained as a process. A process means something which has parts arranged in a temporal sequence. The parts come into existence to serve one single purpose and they are unified in one act of cognition. It is called action. Action is in whole is conveyed by root or dhatu. The verb pachati or cooking consists of other actions such as taking water into the pot, putting the pot on the fire, lighting the fire, etc. In Sanskrit, there are six karakas such as kartrikaraka or agent, karman or object, karana or instrumental, sampradana or dative, apadana or ablative, and adhikarana as locative. Karaka is the relation between verb and the other word in the sentence. Bhartrihari's names karaka as sadhana. They are means, they help to accomplish the action. The use of the words depends on the intention of the speaker or vivaksha than on the outside reality. The non-existence or practically impossible concepts can be expressed through language. For example, if some uses the sentence such as sthali pachati, the pot cooks, grammatically, semantically, this sentence is correct. But actually, according to the world knowledge, this expression is absurd. World of language, these expressions are quite common. So the whole system of sadhana depends on the intention of speaker. A storyteller tells the tales from history where he was not present. The listeners are not present, but the whole story is present in the mind of storyteller and it is evoked in the mind of hearer also. Each karaka performs some minor actions to bring the accomplishment main action which is conveyed by the sentence. Each karaka may be dependent on the main agent or kartri in regard to the main action, but it is independent in regard to its own minor action. So a karaka is that which helps in the accomplishment of an action by assuming different forms, which helps in a general way is called hetu or cause, and which makes something else known is lakshana or sign. According to grammarians, sadhana is a power which inheres in objects. This power is also manifestation of an eternal reality. Thank you.